Okay, so welcome everyone to the session about Drupal 8 entity API. I hope most of you guys made it up here. It wasn't easy to get here up from the keynote. So my name is Wolfgang Ziegler, or Fago is the main handle in the Drupal community, or I'm the real Fago on Twitter. I'm a Drupal developer based in Vienna, Austria, and I'm the maintainer of the entity API module, as well as co-maintainer of the entity and form core components. Yeah, I'm also maintainer of various content modules like rules, field collection, or profile 2, and I'm CEO of a small Drupal shop based in Vienna, Tronomix. So in this talk, I'll talk, of course, about Drupal 8 entity API, and we'll start with a short little bit of history of the entity API in general, and then I'll introduce you to the new API, and we'll demo how you can work with entities and fields in Drupal 8. And you'll also see how you can provide a new entity type. And then I'll shortly cover some new APIs around it, like the entity validation API and the new entity query API, as well as configuration entities. So let's get started with a little bit of history. So entities in Drupal 7, they really were a side effect of the field API being decoupled from nodes. They were introduced rather late in the cycle. Field API was introduced earlier, but it's, we figured out just really late in the cycle that we also need the concept of entities underneath. So the entity API in Drupal 7 really ended up being basically unfinished. So the way around it actually is the entity module, which I've created. You probably know it, the entity API module in Drupal 7. It complements a lot of the missing functionality of the entity API in Drupal core. And yeah, it's a good way to work with, but it's not ideal as it really has to complement what Drupal core provides. So in Drupal 8, really our mission is to make it better out of the box and to have a complete, fully working entity API integrated in Drupal 8 core. So we've been working a lot on that during the last years, and we pretty soon already got to have class-based entity objects in Drupal 8 core, which are based on a defined entity interface, and we also pretty soon got full CRUD storage controllers, what means your entity storage is out of the box capable of not only loading entities as in Drupal 7, but also of saving and deleting entities. So, but then pretty soon we also figured, we had a lot of discussions about on what and for what to use the entity API really. So in Drupal 7, I think a lot of people are thinking of entities mostly of the content of a Drupal site. But then for Drupal 8, we actually figured we want to make all the things entities. So basically everything that you can store and load in Drupal 8 is an entity. So it's not only content, it's also the configuration objects of your site. When you like create a node type or you create a view, those are all entities as well, configuration entities. So we really have two sort of entities. So we have two flavors, like we have the content entity flavor and the config entity flavor. They all are based up my common interface and a common API, the common entity API. But then we have some extensions which are special to like to only content entities or to only configuration entities. Okay, so let's have a look at how you can work with entities now in Drupal 8. So as most things in Drupal 8, it's all object-oriented. So to get started, you really need a service. You've got an entity manager service, which is really the central point of the API. And it's the manager has a lot of methods which allows you to get other dependent objects which then help you to deal with your entities. For example, if you would like to load an entity in Drupal 8, you should get the entity storage of your entity type, in this example the comment, and on this storage object then you can call the load method to load the entity. There's also a shortcut for that, like on each entity class there's automatically a static method, like here load, to load an entity, so you can just use comment load and the ID. but which obviously doesn't work with a dependency injected object. So if you're working in a class in Drupal 8, you should use dependency injection and dependency inject the entity manager or the entity storage. But if it's just like you're implementing a hook in a module and you don't have anything injected, you can just use the shortcut as well. There's a similar shortcut like for creation. As in this example, you can see you can easily create a user object by just passing some values for the fields, and you'll get a new user object. And then each of the objects, as said, is based upon a common interface. The entity interface, and it has some useful methods on it, like to get the entity label, entity ID, or stuff like also the entity type. Then for accessing fields, we actually have a fully-fledged new entity field API in Drupal 8, what means for accessing the value of a field, you don't have to use like the complicated square brackets, language none, zero value stuff, as you know from Drupal 7. Okay, thanks. Yeah, so you can easily just access like field name, value, and that's it. And if your field is multiple, you probably also want to specify which field item you want to use. So of course you can specify that as well by just using the square brackets to specify which one. That actually is optional, so if you don't do that, it will automatically use the first field item to access the value. Yeah. And in this example, we are actually accessing the target ID of a term reference, so pretty easy and straightforward. Then, of course, there are also some methods that make it easier to deal with the fields in an entity, like you can ask an entity whether it has a field of a certain name. And also the field items are objects as well. They also have defined interfaces and also useful methods. Like on a field item, you can just ask the field item to give you the entity on which the field item is. To update field values, it just works with the same Fluent API, just add a new value and save it, and you're good. But apart from that, we have also been trying to add really methods to entity types that are entity type specific and that make sense to a certain entity type, like for nodes. Nodes have special functionality, like they have publishing state, they have created date, they have authors, for all that kind of functionality. We have also added methods. So when there are methods for all those base functionality for entity type, you should use that instead. It's best practice to do that. And if you're providing an entity type, it also makes sense to provide meaningful methods with your entity type as well, just as an interface for those, of course. Then you might have noticed the neat way to access the field values completely misses the language. That is because the translation approach in Drupal 8 works from there different, and that you once get a full translation of your entity object. So when you have an entity object, originally it always uses the values as input by the user, so it always goes with the original entity language. But then you can, on the entity object, call the getTranslation method, pass it the language code, and you will get back a full copy of the entity language with all the translated values in it. And then you can use that copy then to just use the translated entity fields. Then access the title of a node and it will be translated. And you can just access it the same way as for the regular node. Then, as I've shown here, of course, you can use the same methods on the translations as it's just another instance of the same class. And if you ask it about its language, it will tell you the language the translation it is in. And then there's a very convenient method on the entity manager, which is called getTranslationFromContext. And this one actually will make sure to give you the right translation to use for your display context. So when you're displaying something on your site, it will figure out the right translation to get you to use based on the language fallback rules. So you can just use that method, you get back a translation with the right language fallback rules applied, and use that translation for outputting things. And of course, finally, when you have a translation, you can always get back the original entity object by calling getUntranslated method on it. Then entity types really got promoted to a domain object in Drupal 8. That means instead of having that huge array of hook entity info and a lot of keys you have to know in there, we now have a class object based on an interface which just has some convenient methods on it you can easily use to access all the settings of an entity type. So when you get the definition of an entity type, the entity manager, that's basically the equivalent of retrieving entity info in Drupal 7, it will give you back the entity type object. And then you can use the methods on the entity type object. Like you can ask it which entity keys are defined, or whether it's content, configuration entity, and stuff like that. All the settings are in the object. Then, of course, you also have a way to ask the system about the fields that are defined for an entity. And that's actually working about with so-called field definitions. When you have an entity, you can just ask it about the field definitions of all the fields that are on the entity, and it will return the field definition to you, which actually is another object based on another interface. You get the pattern. And yeah, it has convenient methods. It's really the equivalent of the structures that you know of the field API in Drupal 7. But it has been improved to a new and unified API, the entity field API. So you have got field definitions which tell you all the information about the fields, like its name, whether it's multiple or not, which properties are in it, of course, the field type, stuff like that. And when you don't have an entity object yet, you can ask the manager and it will give you all the field definitions of a certain entity type and bundle combination. So what's really nice on Drupal 8 is what Dries already mentioned in the keynote. Everything on content entities now is the field. So like node titles, node created date, or what traditionally in Drupal 7 were entity properties, those are fields now as well. What's really useful, because now we have a really unified way to deal with the data in the entity. So you can easily just take an entity and iterate over the entity object and actually give you back all the field item lists. And it will just have a common API, a common interface for the field API fields as well as the fields that come with your entity type. So all the field item lists are objects based on the field item list interface. And over those, you can iterate as well, and you will get to all the individual field items, and those are based upon the field item interface. And then the individual field items you can use, of course, to access the individual field item property values, like just the value of a text field or the target ID of an entity reference. So as you might think, we now have different flavors of fields still a little bit, because a field that's defined like in the interface still behaves a little bit different than a field that comes with a module. So for that, we now have the concept of base fields and bundle fields. So the base fields basically are what were the entity properties back then in Drupal 7. It's like the node title, node IDs, username, or the user roles. Those would all be examples of base fields. And what's common to that is that that those fields are each on each instance of an entity regardless of the bundle. Like when you have a node, regardless of the content type, those fields are always on each node. But then the bundle fields, those fields are really bundle specific. That means that they only appear on the entity type and bundle combination for which they have been configured to which they have been assigned. Yeah?
So this means that
so the question was whether all entities now should define a bundle, even as a single one of them. So the answer to this is yes. That's already sort of the way you have to do it for Drupal 7 for being able to use field API. It's not like it's strictly required, but you really should do it. And we even might get there to do that automatically for you if you don't define it. So that shouldn't be a big deal. But yes, all the field API fields, as mentioned, they really are bundle specific. So everything that you configure there is related to an entity type and bundle combination. So configurable fields, I already used that term. It's actually the term we are using now for field API fields. So everything that used to be field API, we just call now configurable, and it's still provided by the field module. But what's different is that the field module now integrates with a more common entity field API. So those fields are just a certain flavor of field which are actually managed and backed by the configuration system, which the field module takes care of. And those fields also, of course, appear in the UI by default, and they just implement the same interfaces as all the other fields. So it's really just the management and the configuration that's special, but else it's all the same as for the others. So fields-deutsch definitions is a new concept we introduced rather recently. Also, it's very easy to get when you have the analogy to Drupal 7 field API. Like field instances, it basically is what in Drupal entity field API are now the field definitions. Those are really fully working fields which are complete, and you can use it as they are, like we use widgets and formatters with it and everything. But then there's also the field config, which is really just a definition of the field storage of the data bucket that's used to store the values of a field, which are shared across all the bundles. And the field storage definition really is just a general entity field API concept of that. And there's also, of course, a method on the entity manager to get to all the field storage definitions of an entity type if you need that. And finally, we also have module-provided fields now in Drupal 8. Already mentioned, field module is one module that provides all the configurable fields based on the configuration management system. But really, you could write a module that provides its own fields which are not backed by config. So you can just implement one of the hooks, like you can implement hook entity bundle field info and define another field for an entity and bundle combination. And it's really the same for hook entity base fields. You can you add further base fields to an entity for that. And hook entity field storage is really just for field storage definitions. Finally, of course, when you have a field definition, you can ask it which module has provided that. So speaking of field storage got moved into the entity storage, so that's not a separate system anymore. In Drupal 7, entity storage and field storage were separate independent components, but they figured that doesn't make a lot of sense, so we moved the field storage into the entity storage, but actually makes it much easier to implement a new storage engine, because you can just swap out the storage for a whole entity type as a whole by swapping out the entity storage, and you don't have to swap out multiple components. So the entity storage takes over field storage even for configurable fields, but you can also define a field with custom storage, what means then you as a module would have to take over storing the data of a field customly. And then finally, there are also fields without any storage that are so-called computed fields. And a computed field actually just allows you to compute something when it's accessed on the fly. So it's like just an magic field item property that when you access it, the value gets computed in the back, and that's it. So there's no storage behind that. Huh? With views? The question was whether computer fields work with views. No, I don't see how that would work, but no. That's actually, there are not many examples of computed fields in Drupal 8 core. It's like those two examples which I have on that slide are the only two I know. It's actually the processed property of a text item is basically just the text format applied. So it computes the output of the inputted text, applies the text format, and it's just the final text ready for output. So you can get that by just accessing the processed computed property. So you don't have to use the text sanitize function, which was it in Drupal 7. Then also very convenient is when you are dealing with entity references is that those references also have a computed entity property. So in addition to the target ID field item property, which we have already seen, you can just use dash entity and you will get the fully loaded referenced entity object and just continue working with that and chain full. So that's very convenient when you work with entity references. Yeah, so I've talked quite a bit now about fields. So you might wonder how fields actually relate to configuration entities. So all, as mentioned, everything on the content entity is a field, but on the config entity, actually nothing is a field. We have all entity properties on there, which are really just like simple plain object properties. So when you access a property on a view, which is a configuration entity, it won't be an object, it will be just whatever is in that property. So if you access the view name, it will be directly a string. Well, when you access the node title, that actually is going to be a field object, in particular a field item list object. So you'll have to use arrow value to get the string of the node title. So that really is a major difference of when you work with configuration and content entities right now. Okay, let's have a look on how you could actually use the new API to provide new entity types. And I'll really start with a content entity type and focus on that mostly, and later on I have a short look at on configuration entities and how those work as well. So for defining an entity type in Drupal 8, you basically just have to define a class and put an annotation on it. So that's really the basic principle of the plugin system in Drupal 8. In case you don't know, it's really simple. You just have class, put the right annotation on it, put it in the right location, and the system will pick it up automatically. So it works really like that for entities as well. So if you can see here, there's a defined class for the comment, just extends the base class, implements in a defined interface as well, and the annotation on it actually specifies all that information that in Drupal 7 was part of hook entity info. So that's all now in one central place and as it really belongs together. And as in Drupal 7, the information that you specify is quite similar. Like you have to specify the machine name, the label, stuff like that. And then more important are all the different controllers, which are all the classes which take care of how your entity behaves in the system, but we'll have a closer look at those now. Then when you define the entity class, what you also need to define is the fields which are on your entity. For that, there's a static function which is called base field definitions. You just implement it and basically return an array of field definitions that are on your entity. So, for example, in comment entity, it comes, of course, with fields like comment ID, UUID, but then also has parent comment ID, comment subject. All those would be examples of the comment base fields. So you implement the method base field definitions, create field definitions for all of the fields and return it. For creating field definitions, you can just use the class field definition, create a new instance, pass the field type, and then you have methods to define all the further details of a field definition. Usually you want to define a label, but of course there are stuff like field type dependent settings. So for entity reference, you also have to specify like the targets type setting, which defines what entity type is being referenced. Then what's really a nice feature and I really like about the new API in Drupal 8, I must say, is that we now are able to use widgets and formatters on base fields as well. So that means like this is the definition for widgets and formatters of the node title. So the node title is now actually rendered with a field formatter and is being edited with a field widget. You can configure which format and widget to use with the setDisplayOptions method. You just pass the ID of the widget or formatter at the type option, and you can specify like the weight and some additional settings there as well. And then very important also is the setDisplayConfigurable method, which allows you to specify whether the widget or the format is actually configurable for the user in the UI. So if you're providing an entity type and you don't want the user to be able to configure your base fields, you just don't have to enable that, but you still can make use of all the widgets and the formatters that are already in the system. But if you want the configurability, you can easily just turn it on as well, and it will just work as for configurable fields. Then speaking of storage, for implementing the storage of your entity type, you just have to specify the class, which is content entity database storage, which is a class you can just use, and that will provide you with full CRUD storage for your entity type. And then you always just have to implement the hook schema, which means you have to define all the information that's in your base fields again. So we thought we can do better. So since Sunday, we actually don't have to implement hook schema anymore. And it will generate it automatically for you based on the field definitions. So you really have just to take... Oh, thanks. So you just have to take care of your field definitions, make sure they are well-defined. Like, you can also define whether the fields are revisionable or translatable, and the system will generate the right tables for you and will take care of doing that. Then sometimes it's not enough to just have entity storage and entity query to work with your entity type, but you need some additional queries, like talking directly to the database. So in Drupal 8, you really should encapsulate all that direct access to the database in the storage layer. So if you need that, just introduce a new method on your entity storage class, add it to its interface, like here it's defined in common storage interface. So everyone who would like to swap out the storage of your entity types easily sees where you're talking to the storage and can provide fitting replacement implementation. And then to work with entity storage, as we have seen before, you can just use the manager called get storage on it and use whatever storage method you want to use, like save an entity, load it. Then any storage independent logic, it shouldn't go into the entity storage, of course. So for that, we have provided like utility methods on the entity class, which get invoked by the storage. So like all the hooks, you know, like a pre-save hook. Also, we have post-save for insert and update. All those hooks have equivalents in the entity class. So there's a method on it, which is actually called before the hooks and allows the entity type to implement any storage independent logic. Then for rendering a content entity, you actually can just use the view builder. You just specify the class in the entity annotation, and you're actually good to go. It will just render all the fields with the formatters that are defined for the fields. Then for forms, it actually works really similar. There's entity form class, which will by default use all formatters. But in addition to that, also entity operation forms, like the form to delete the form, are also handled via entity forms, and you can easily customize them as well. Of course, you just extend the base class, and you can override methods like for overriding the question of the deletion form. And then to access the form, you have to do that via an entity form builder service, which then has get form method, and it will gets the entity form for you. So that's actually looking rather complex, but the good thing is that usually you won't have to do that, because in the routing system, there's already a special key called entity form, which you just specify, and you specify which form, and it basically just pulls in the defined entity form for you. So you don't really have to do the glue code either. So you just specify the form in your route. Then for access control, there's also a separate access controller. which you usually want to extend to specify your custom entity access control functionality. You just extend the method and implement a suiting method for defining the default access of your entity type. It's really straightforward. And then, of course, to check access on any entity type, you can just get the access controller from the entity manager and call the access method on it. Then finally, there's something called entity lists that is actually mostly used by configuration entities, as it's useful for providing like an overview screen in administration UI, so you have a list of all the entities in your systems. And yeah, the entity list controller comes with a usual predefined list, which of course you can modify by extending the entity list controller and overriding some methods. For content entities, actually, Fuse is used all over core, so that's why entity lists are mostly used for configuration entities. But I guess you've seen there's really a pattern behind all those entity controllers and how you can use that. So it's really is about providing reusable functionality based upon a well-defined interface, so everyone can easily make use of the functionality, but also the entity controllers really allow you to easily customize certain aspects of your entity type, so you can always just easily extend the provided controller, override some methods, so it's really sets a pattern for that. And finally, entity controllers can easily be provided by content modules, so they can provide new sorts of new flavors of entity controllers, so they can allow other entity types to easily customize the behavior of a content module. So it's really a neat and easy way for modules to allow for easy per entity type customization. So if you know controllers like from the MVC pattern, you might be actually a little bit confused about the term entity controller because it's totally not a controller in the MVC pattern. So as Drupal 8 also uses the term controller that way now, it's actually a little bit confusing to have entity controllers and controllers in the MVC pattern sense. So we actually think about renaming controllers to handlers, so just to avoid any terminology confusing. Yeah, but that doesn't really impact on how you work with them anyway. But there's even another pattern. So Fields really introduce a new way to provide you with reusable behavior along with storage for entity types. And there are multiple examples for that in core already. Like we have got now a new UUID field. So all the content entities have UUIDs in Drupal core. And it's just a field that's defined for each of those. And the field actually encapsulates all the behavior that's really specific to the UUID field, which mostly means like, okay, when the entity is created, a new UUID will be generated for your entity, and it also comes with meaningful validation for your UUID. Actually, that's an example of a field type which is not exposed to the user interface. So when the user goes to the Manage Field screen and adds some fields, the UUID field won't pop up. So you can configure that by field type. Then another example would be the language field, which really similar is just used for the entity language and comes with a meaningful default value behavior. Then there's a path field, which is used for the path aliases of nodes or terms. And it's interesting from that perspective as it also implements methods that react on entity insert, update, or deletion to control the path alias that gets stored in the pack. So it really is a nice way to encapsulate that logic as well. You don't have to implement the hooks in the module, but can also move that logic directly in your field type. And it really helps to encapsulate the functionality. Then, yeah, of course, we have more of those, like created and changed fields are good examples which come with meaningful default value behavior as well. So, yeah. Then, as mentioned, we also have a new entity validation API. Entity validation actually really is important because of the RESTful web service that Drupal 8 ships with. Because with the web service, you really want the web service to run all the validation that it's needed for your entity type, so to be sure that all the data is actually valid. You don't really want it to skip it, so we cannot do all the validation in the form layer as it was done in Drupal 7. So we decided to move all the validation logic to a separate entity validation API, which is totally decoupled from the form layer and can be used without forms as well. And so we are actually using another Symfony component for that. There's a Symfony validator component, which works based on a set of constraint plugins, which means there are a lot of useful constraints, like for checking the length of something, the range, and really there are a bunch of them. And you can just reuse them to define your validation constraints of a feed. And it's actually working like that. There's a method set property constraints on the field definition, which allows you to easily set constraints on all the individual field item properties. And as well, there are methods like to set constraint on the whole field as well. And here you specify just the ID of the constraint. So in this case, it's a custom user mail unique constraint, and you also can specify some constraint options. In that case, the constraint doesn't take any options. So the user mail constraint is just a custom implementation that makes sure that the mail address the people enter are actually unique. And what's really nice about the constraints is also that field types can define default constraints, like an email field comes just with a constraint to validate that what the input is an email address by default. And then to making use of the API, there's a validate method on an entity which you can call, and it will validate the whole entity for you and give you back a list of validation violations. And to see whether entity validation passed, you actually can just check the count of the violations as seen here. So if the count is greater than zero, obviously there was a violation and validation failed. And if it equals zero, the validation passed. Then when you have a violation, the violation are actually represented as object as well, and it's gives you easy access to the an error message, which is already properly translated and everything. It's ready for you to use. And it also has a reference on the actual property that failed validation. So in that example, it's actually the filter format of a text field. Then the mapping back of the violation errors actually is taking over by the widgets. So when you are implementing that, just make sure that for field you have a widget in place, and it will automatically map back the violations to form errors as well. Then, of course, you can define new constraint plugins. It's again working based upon the plugin system. You usually define a class and a defined location, put an annotation on it. It's all following the same pattern. Actually, the constraint class here is used for the constraint settings and the messages. So this constraint contains the default messages, and then the actual validation is done by another class, the so-called constraint validator, which you just specify here by the validated by class, and by default just uses the naming pattern like for range, it's a range validator, so you don't have to override it. Yeah, entity query also got improved a lot for Drupal 8. Here I really just took the most important things. So first off, it's really abstracted now. It's easy to for each entity storage to provide each own entity query component as well. So like MongoDB can provide a new entity storage layer as well, a new query class which automatically supports all the entities that are stored with its storage layer. So that's something very, very important and very useful to work with. And as everything now is a field. You don't have to specify like whether you are querying a property or a condition anymore, whether you're querying a property or a field anymore. There's just a general condition method on it, and you can use it the same way, really, like dbtng works in Drupal 7, so it's more close to that now. But when you execute it, you always get back the array of entity IDs, and you can easily load the entities from there. Yeah, so it works independently of the storage, and it's defined actually by an entity query service that gets reused and by the storage. So what's really nice about it is that it now also has language support, which means you can easily query entity translations via it. It has relationship support, but that's of course only possible if your entity types are based on the same storage engine. Like you can only use relations when both entity types are like stored in SQL and the entity query driver supports it. Then there's also aggregation support, like for counts and everything. Okay, then let's have a short look at configuration entities. As I talked mostly about content entities now. As mentioned, it's really based on the same API, so the base pattern is the same. You define an entity class, but we have a different base class you can use for config entities, which come with meaningful default behavior for them. And then for the you put also the annotation on your entity class, and have some different definitions. Like in particular, you have to define like a config prefix, which is the prefix for the configuration management system to store the content of the entity in a configuration management file. And that actually is going to be taken over by the provided storage component. You don't have to customize that. Yeah, so when you're providing a configuration entity, what you usually do to define what's stored for your configuration entity is, instead of defining base fields, you just define public properties, like public object properties on your entity class, and all of those properties are by default picked up by the configuration system and stored. So actually that is what will be returned in the toArray method, and that is what's being picked up. So if you want to customize what's going to be stored for a configuration entity, you can override the toArray method and add or customize whatever data is returned by the method will be stored. Then finally, when you provide a configuration entity, you really should provide a configuration schema as well. It's not technically required for the entity to work, but it's required for the translation system to work with your configuration entity. So it actually goes in a separate file, and I won't go into the details here as it's not really related to the entity API, but you basically just define the schema for all of the entity properties that you are going to store in your configuration file. Question is whether that means whether the config is generated automatically. So you have to define the schema for the configuration of your configuration entity, but then of course for each instance, for each entity that you're going to save, the config file is generated and saved for you. I hope that answers the question. Then I also want to shortly mention the type data API, which really is an underlying API of all the entity field API. You don't really have to know about it directly for being able to work with the entity API, but it's really built deeply into the system. And this API is really an API about metadata and being able to leverage the metadata. So it allows you to describe your data using type data definitions, or like field definitions, which are really similar to that. And the API works based on an extendable list of data types, which are predefined in Drupal core. Like you have data types for the primitive data types, like string, integer, or float. But of course, it also covers all Drupal-specific data types, like entities, nodes, so field items of a certain field type. And it really helps the modules like the REST module for providing web service in Drupal 8 core, and content modules are going to use it a lot, like rules or ctools, Drupal 8 variant, or search API is already going to build up on that, and hopefully we also will be able to have tokens generated based on the type data API. So you've seen we are almost there. We have really achieved a lot, I think, for the Drupal 8 entity API. But as always, we are not totally there. It's not everything finished, so we are still working on some items and trying to get ready for the beta. Mostly, our focus right now is actually on completing the schema generation, and that it also it's possible to handle changes to the entity schema. So right now, that's not possible. That's really one of the YouTube beta blockers we are working on a lot this week and this time. And what's really great about that is also will ease reusing entity field storage for modules, because that means when you have a module and you want to store some data for the entity, you don't have to create your own database table for that anymore. You can just use the system, implement the hook, and add a field to it, and the entity storage will be able to take care of the storage for your field for you, and you can just reuse that. And finally, we are also working on entity cache support and getting that in. It's actually already pretty ready, and we are close to having that committed as well. And entity render caching actually is already done, so that's a really nice performance improvement as well. Yeah, so if you're interested in all that, you're really welcome to get involved. We have a meta issue, which is called Complete the Entity Field API, which should give you an overview of all the issues being worked on. And we have also weekly IRC meetings in Drupal-Entity, which happens each Thursday at 6 o'clock Central European time. That's 7 hours from this time zone. Yeah, and of course, we have sprints here on DrupalCon. So if you're interested in get involved, or getting involved with Drupal coding in general, not necessarily just entity API, really come to the sprints. They happen on Friday. There are a lot of tasks for every skill set. There are mentors available that help new contributors, and there is even a workshop to help you to set up with the community tools. Okay, so also before we move on to the questions, I want to use the opportunity and highlight some of my other pet projects. As mentioned, I'm also a maintainer of the rules module. And right now, we are actually starting an initiative to get the rules module ported to Drupal 8. And we have started a Drupal funders campaign where you try to gather funds so we can move on with the port of the module faster, so we can also use work hours. And because we really want to get the module ported as soon as possible and don't postpone the release to someone really late. And I don't think that anyone wants to happen that. So if you like rules, please visit drupal.org and support us. So, okay, that's it. Any questions? Maybe come over to the microphone and speak into that, please. So questions.
Yeah, so you mentioned a little bit about entity querying, like the way entity field query works now in Drupal 7. Does views use that by default? Because now I'm trying to do remote entity stuff and entity views, entity field query views, and it's you know, tricky to wire all that together.
So, no, unfortunately, views is not using entity query yet, so there's been some discussion about it. So it's still its own query system. But I really hope that there will also be a contrib effort that will provide a query plugin that's based up on entity query for Fuse. It's doable, but it's not done in Drupal 8 core.
Thanks a lot.
Welcome.
Thanks, Fago. Everyone who's worked on this is amazing. My question is about the piece that you were talking about. You're trying to get the schema automatically generated based upon the storage definitions, and you're having problems with migrations. Like if you generated that schema and then you wanted to add another field. You know, you want, don't want to throw out what you did. You want to be able to just make that additional field added, or maybe the type of the field changed or something like that. Where are you currently with that work?
Yeah, so as mentioned, that's the handle changing of to the entity schema, and that's one of the issues we are still working on. So that's not there in Drupal 8 at all right now. So right now you can just provide field definitions and that's it. You cannot change it. But we are working on it and we will introduce a way for you to add new fields. But you will be limited in what changes you will be able to do. Like as it's already the case for configurable fields, they don't allow you to change like the field type of an existing field because there's no upgrade for your storage. We will also limit like what you will be able to do with changes. And
so we should be prepared to do it right the first time or throw it out?
Well, you can always just add another field and migrate your data yourself, but there will be no fancy data migration in the back for just right. When you change field.
So if you make a mistake, catch it early before all the data is flooded in.
Yeah, that's a good idea to do it.
Gotcha.
Yeah, but something there.
Just in addition to Fago's answer, we are not allowing these kind of changes in core because it would mean introducing a lot of complexity, but actually it would be possible to provide in Contrib an alternative handler for these changes that could leverage the migrate API we are introducing in Drupal core, so that actually could support a wider range of changes and providing data migration while doing that, so actually we could be able to address the concerns that he was pointing out.
Thanks. More questions?
So one of the things that we've noticed building with D7 and all previous versions of Drupal is that the user system and registration is one of the most magic and sort of hardwired part of everything we've gotten used to. And a lot of our challenges come around registration and hiding usernames or allowing for non-unique email addresses and things like that. And I may be missing the obvious, but it seems as if everything is now a first-class field on all entity types, that stuff like overriding the requirement that email addresses be unique is now possible. Does that seem to be the case? Is there some way provided for us to say, no, you don't have to have a unique email address?
Actually, that's not something that the conversion does take care of. It like it makes sure that it's defined like that and it's available to everyone that you know it's unique, but it's not making it magically work that you change the field definition and everything takes care of the change as well. So it's always like when you alter something, you have to know what you alter and what's actually working or not.
So as Dries touched on in the Q&A, this is a pretty radical evolution, and it's going to be pretty tricky for many developers to learn all these changes and make these changes in how we do our work. Some of that is a bit some of that challenge is a bit offset in that now that because everything is object oriented, it's a lot easier to sort of discover how the pieces interact and work together as long as the IDE can sort of automatically discover these relationships and everything like that. But naturally there is sort of a limit in how far an IDE can discover it. You know, for example, the IDE isn't going to know what fields are on your node. But can you maybe speak to some of the things that are in place to make that sort of discoverability happen and how we can leverage that?
We really tried to have the discoverability built in as far as possible, but as mentioned, of course, for dynamic stuff like the fields, it's not possible out of the box. But I think what we could do here is really work with the IDEs to have integrated IDE support, like have special plugins that are able to parse like your configuration and based on that can give you autocomplete suggestions. I think that's actually doable for most IDEs.
Great presentation, thank you. My question is about, with these changes to configurations being entities now, how does that impact the features module? And can you talk about that a little bit?
Actually, not too knowledgeable of the configuration system, but it really the configuration system is an underlying system that the features module would need. So it really takes care of being able to stage of all of the configuration from a dev side to staging side to a live side, and it's also possible to make individual modules with come a bunch of default configuration items, and really feature module can work based on that and to provide all the glue to automatically generate and maintain the modules, I think.
Thanks for the presentation, and I get a question about base fields and bundle fields. So at the moment, stuff like title, they're actually stored in properties. So actually moving it into a base field, does it mean that actually each field is going to have its own table? Or does it mean that actually we will be able to choose if we can want to store it as a database column or as a separate table? Mm.
So configurable fields are stored as in Drupal 7. So they're using this basically the same approach of one table per field. But base fields are still in use and as efficient table layout as possible, so we generate it depending on the revisionable and translatable flags, what means like for nodes there's a table with the data of all the base fields in it basically. So out of the box, it means for each configurable field added, it will be add another table, but what it also means is that more easily you could just convert a configurable field like to a base field and have better and improved storage, while all the API that's working with that field is actually the same, so the rest of the system actually won't care whether it's a configurable field or what's a base field and how the storage treats it, so you really have everything in your hands to improve the storage and easily make a more efficient storage without having anything of the rest of the system notice.
So does it mean that new nodes in Drupal 8 gonna have title as a separate in a separate table?
They could, but right now the title is stored as Drupal 7, like it's all in one table.
All right, thanks.
So now that properties are fields, does that mean that I can like put an image above my title without like hacking all of pre-process?
Good question. I don't know. You would have to try, but I hope so.
Cool. Thank you.